This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Hi, this is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. Welcome to my new abode. Things have changed around here. The only thing that hasn't changed is the picture of Annie on the back wall behind me, and now the original painting from the communion cover is beside her, and a beautiful crop circle painting, photograph sent to me a long time ago by a dear friend and former webmaster, James Beeson. And my books are on the other side, a lot of my books, and it's a warmer, nicer environment in which I am very pleased to bring today someone you know well and who is one of our most popular guests for a reason. He is one of the best researchers and diggers out there. I'd like to welcome Preston Dennett to the show. Hello, Preston. Welcome. And I'm so glad to have you back for the 116th time, at least. I'm looking forward to a great morning. The new book is, I got a bunch of questions all written out for you. So let's get started. How are things going? And it's just in general in your world.
Oh, not bad. Keeping real busy, having fun still, continually surprised with this whole subject of UFOs and all that comes with it.
Yeah.
So, yeah, always working on another book. Dolly says hi, by the way, working on symmetry number 2 about her experiences. So yeah.
Oh, great.
Busy.
Yeah, that's wonderful. I think that I'm, in my case, I'm working on my new book and I hope to have it out by Christmas. I used to say I hope to have it out by April. Then I hope to have it out by October. Now Christmas. Now, this new book in the Not From Here series, I believe it's the 4th or 5th book in the series.
Number 5.
Yeah. But there's something very special about it. In the past, all of the books have been basically taking a more magnified look at certain UFO events or situations. This is all new material. And there's so much old material still out there. Why did you choose to go in the direction of new?
Because I still had some things I wanted to explore. You know, this Not From Here volume was basically drawn from the many articles I've written over 35 years of research now. And, you know, some of those articles were excerpts from various books, and I didn't want to use those because you can get them in my various books. But a bunch of them were published only in magazines, which have a very short shelf life and really weren't accessible to people. So that was kind of my goal, is to make, because a good portion of my research was just not available. And I basically got most of it out except for a couple of articles. And I thought, you know what, I still have some other ideas here. So let's just make this last volume, volume 5, which is probably going to be the last one for at least some time, and complete this mission that I have. And I've had so much fun with these volumes because I get to explore sort of avenues of research and patterns of cases that are a little bit controversial, perhaps, a little bit of outliers, haven't been explored before, not in any depth, perhaps. I've had a lot of fun with it, but this is probably going to be the last for a while. And this one, yeah, has got some new stuff in it that I've never really looked into before and certainly surprised me. You think you know something, and then along comes a new case and it sends you down an avenue of research you never expected to go down.
That is so true, boy, for all of us. I have to say there's a little bit of an autumn leaves quality in what you just said. Are you planning to pull out, or am I misreading?
No, just, you know, there are times it's a little overwhelming. I'm done. I can't take, you know, because you kind of live, breathe, and eat, and it's a 24-hour thing with this subject. But no, I'm not pulling out. I'm in for the long haul. I've got three or four more books I'm already working on. A couple of, like, Symmetry 2, another UFO book. I'm going to do one on out-of-body experiences, because I did one on that and still have more. A little branch out more paranormal a bit, but no, I'm in for the long haul.
Yeah, you know a lot about out-of-body experiences, as I recall, and you're able to have them. I've had a few very powerful ones, but very, very few, and I'm only responsible for initiating one of them, and I don't think I really initiated it. Tell us a little bit more.
Yeah, I mean, I became interested in out-of-body experiences following the death of my mother. I was young, 19. She was young too, 49. So as you can imagine, this was very unexpected and tragic. And I was a skeptic at the time of all things paranormal, life after death, UFOs, ghosts, you name it. And even, you know, a couple of weeks later after she passed at the service, I did see her spirit driving up in the car, sitting next to my father. It was her sitting in the front seat. And of course, I didn't think ghost or spirit. I thought, well, I'm hallucinating with grief. And thought, this is going to be my deep, dark secret. I'm not telling anyone. Because there are people on either side of me and no one's reacting. I'm like, well, you know, this must be a hallucination. Don't think it was in hindsight. I think I did see her spirit, because it wasn't long after that she started visiting me in my room, in my dreams, lucid dreams. It was very strange because it happened over and over again where she'd walk in and I'd wake up. I was sure I was awake. She would basically try to tell me that she's okay, not to grieve, everything's going to be fine. And then I would wake up for real. So these were like false awakenings, which turns out to be a signal of lucid dreaming. That's what got me interested in the subject and dreams, which led to picking up Robert Monroe's book, Out of Body Journeys, which was very compelling, very believable, a little scary, but he gave exercises on how to do it. And I thought, well, let's give it a try. This is a way you can actually experience this yourself. And it worked. You know, little exercises on meditation and relaxation and visualizations. Took me about a month and a half before I had my first OBE. I knew right then and there, there was life after death, that he was telling the truth, and had one the next weekend after that, because I'm very busy at this time. I'm going through college. I'm working pretty much full time. I didn't have a whole lot of free time and was only doing this on weekends, but I never looked back. I mean, I doubled down on the meditations and started having them regularly. I'm still having them to this day.
Wow. That's all I can say. You know, you mentioned that no one else saw her in the car. That takes me to something that Anne said right after she died. It looks like everyone is intentionally ignoring us, which is, you know, except you, and in my case, me. And I wonder how many people... Oh, you know, before we go on, let's take the opportunity between questions to take a little break. We'll be right back.
And by the way, go to unknowncountry.com and get on the newsletter. It's easy to do. It's completely free. It comes out every Friday like clockwork, and you'll enjoy it. And it keeps you up to date with all the stuff going on around here, what the next Dreamland's going to be, what the next subscriber events are going to be, who's going to be in the subscriber video chat. Because, you know, as subscribers, you get a lot of chances to chat personally with these guests. It happens all the time on UC. So go to UC and get started. UnknownCountry.com.
I'm here with my dear friends, Sue Wong and Lee McCloskey, in Sue's incredible home in Malibu overlooking the Pacific. And giving them my book, my new book, A Hidden Garden, my book of poems that I have been meaning to write for many years, and now here it is. And many of you know him as a wonderful writer and investigator into all things mysterious and possible, but he's also an extraordinary poet and a wonderful poetic soul. So A Hidden Garden, the poems of Whitley Strieber, and he gave Sue and I copies, and get your own.
Thank you. I'm very honored. Thank you so much, Whitley.
Thanks.
We're talking to Preston Dennett. We're talking about his new book in the Not From Here series. We're getting to it. We've segued into OBEs. We'll segue back soon. There's a lot to talk about today. Certain people can kind of see, and you're certainly one of them. Why do you think that is?
You know, I honestly can't say for sure. I'm 5 of 6 kids. There was a lot of us. And here I am kind of going off the deep end with all of this. And everyone's looking at me like I'm a little bit, you know, crazy, honestly. I'm like, haven't any of you had any experiences like this? And it turned out that privately they told me they did. Not necessarily seeing a spirit directly, but certainly dreams or feelings of a presence. I think people have a tendency to ignore what's out of their worldview, what kind of challenges their belief system. I've always been kind of a sensitive guy. I did have a couple of profound psychic instances as a young child. So maybe there's something to that. But I was always kind of a meditative, philosophical guy. Maybe that's a factor here. I don't know. Hard to say for sure. I suspect everyone has these kinds of experiences, but I have a tendency to sort of brush them off or explain them away.
Yeah, exactly. That's what we do. We explain these things away, and we shouldn't do it because there's something about life that there's more here. And if we keep brushing it away, eventually it ignores us. If you keep going for it, it responds. That's my experience anyway. So now you've also written this, well, you know, instead of, we're going to talk about more about in depth about OBEs and human levitation and preview Preston's new book in a little while. I wanted to go into Not From Here. Now, this is a book that, first of all, the series folks is, if you're not into it, if you want to learn something about UFOs and about the history of this whole thing, that's where to go. The whole series is just top drawer. It's excellent. Now, you start out in the book with, I believe, with UFO swarms, if I'm not correct. Yes. Okay. Why did you choose that? And tell us a little bit about what that is, even.
Yeah, I would call UFO swarm basically a super fleet. It's not unusual for when people see a UFO. Actually, it's more common than not to see multiple objects. I've interviewed a lot of people, and people report a UFO sighting. There's usually one or two or three in the sky. But it's not unusual for people to report more than that, 5 or even 10 or 20. But above that, no, that's very unusual. And yet I did have a case pretty early on in my research. A wave of sightings occurred over Topanga Canyon. This was starting on June 14th, 1992. Topanga is a community right outside of Los Angeles in Southern California. And a bunch of people were calling the police on that evening, the local newspaper. This is where I grew up, so I knew the area well. I knew a lot of people. I just moved out to a neighboring town. But it turned out on that one night alone, some 30, 40 different groups of witnesses in various locations were seeing UFOs. Some saw one or two objects. A few were chased down the highway. Some had them landing next to their homes or hovering over their houses. One guy he was driving through the canyon, and he saw a very large craft emitting about 20 smaller craft. He had two friends with him as well. They watched it for 20 or 30 minutes before driving off. But I did talk to one couple who don't want their names used. I called them Daniel and Catherine. They live very high in elevation in an area which overlooks the Pacific Ocean and LA and pretty much a 360 degree view. And early that evening, June 14th, they saw a group of 10 or 20 objects come up from behind the ridge, dart off in various directions. And 5 or 10 minutes later, they saw another group. And when this happened a third time, 10 or more objects came up from behind this ridge. They started counting them. It started at 8 o'clock and it went till about 10, 10:30, when they actually closed the curtains, shut the doors, and refused to look outside anymore because this was so upsetting. They counted more than 200 objects. And that, yeah, that's insane.
I wonder what these were, because, you know, I have some friends, some dear friends, who have a house by a lake in upstate New York. And one night, I recall it as being like an hour, glowing orbs came up out of the lake and went into the sky one after another, or maybe went down into the lake. But in any case, what do you make of something like that, Preston? What does it mean? Or does it have any meaning that we can discern?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know for sure. You're asking me to speculate, which is fun, but I try to avoid it. I'm guessing this was either, you know, some major operation where they're going out and contacting people, because these were craft. These were fairly large. One came right over their head and they saw it was kind of a half disc shape, made a low buzzing noise, your classic kind
of. These were not light. They were physical things.
Right.
Absolutely. Yeah. The ones that saw that, I think that when we see these things at night, we're actually often seeing physical craft, but they, you know, we only see what parts of them glow.
Yeah, I think they've got, you know, a lot of plasma perhaps surrounding the craft.
Yes.
Because I've got a lot of cases of that where people see a star-like light and it comes down, 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 and boom, it's metallic.
Yeah, when you say plasma, I'm going to digress here a little bit, but that's how we work together and we talk together. When you say plasma, what do you think that plasma is? What's it all about?
Superheated gas, our atmosphere reacting to the high temperatures surrounding these craft. I say that having talked to a lot of contactees. Dolly Safran is one I'll reference. I often bring her up because she...
Yeah, well, we had a wonderful time with Dolly on this show. I remember very vividly. And folks, if you're a subscriber, just input Dolly, DollySafron, into the search engine and you can watch that show. Or you can watch it on YouTube if you have the link. So that was very extraordinary. Yeah, and I personally have been close to these things a number of times, and I'm not remembering heat, but then again, I haven't been close to them when it was running. You know who remembered a great deal of heat was Betty Andreasen. Remember I wonder if that's a kind of mixed up screen memory of being close to a UFO when she's talking about the heat and she sees this phoenix come up, and maybe that's all kind of a rearranged, I wouldn't say screen, but rearranged memory.
It does come up in a number of cases. I remember in the Westall High School case in Melbourne, Australia, 1966. The students ran right up to this craft, which they said was blazing with heat. And I know of other cases like that. Dolly Safran, you know, having had a lot of experiences, she says this is one of the reasons they actually go into the water, is to cool down.
Maybe so.
And I saw, you know, after she said that, I started looking up cases where these objects would go into the water and steam would rise up. And clearly that's what they were doing, cooling off their craft. Yeah, I think
does rise up. I know people who've seen that.
Yeah, I suspect that's what's going on here.
Yeah, exactly. Free Dreamland, we're going to take another break. We'll be right back. We're talking to Preston Dennett. His new book, Not From Here, the latest volume, you can get it through the unknowncountry.com store. Just go to unknowncountry.com, click on the store tab, click on podcast authors, and you'll be right there with all of our fascinating podcast authors. Talk about an incredible library. I've got one. Part of it's right back there, and it's because of this show. And Preston's books are certainly in it, and they should be in yours as well. PrestonDennett.weebly.com. That's the, see, here I am pushing 80, and I really have a good memory. I can remember all my guests' website addresses and everything. So anyway, we'll be right back.
Introduction to the 2022 edition, An Awakening World. Since Communion was published in October of 1987, there has been a significant advance in how we understand the presence that most people think of as aliens. In recent years, this advance has accelerated steadily. We are right at the edge of official admission that somebody is here, and along with it, acceptance of this as a fact. But who? Or should that be what? When Communion was written, somebody claiming alien contact was publicly called a liar or pitied or being mentally disturbed. I experienced these reactions. Only, more or less in secret and to my great surprise, something else happened. As soon as the book was published, there was an explosion of interest. Derided and suppressed though it was, contact between human beings and the entities I had begun to call the visitors was not only happening, it was proving to be more widespread than anybody realized. And yet, due to social engineering of some kind, possibly originating with government agencies that had realized what was going on and also understood that they were powerless to stop it, the entire culture, from science and the academy to the man on the street, was being led to believe that it was all lies and craziness. Well, it's not all lies and craziness. And the way to find out more, and if you'd like to listen, go to audible.com and sign up and get a copy of Communion read by me.
Hi, everyone. This is Kelly Chase. I'm Dreamland's new monthly guest host. You can catch me here on the last Friday of every month. If you're interested in checking out my other work, you can find that on my podcast, The UFO Rabbit Hole. On that show, I share my own personal research with deep dives into everything from historical cases to philosophical frameworks, as well as in-depth interviews with top thinkers in the field, like Jeffrey Kripal, Diana Walsh Pasulka, Bernardo Kastrup, James Madden, and of course, Dreamland's own Whitley Strieber. You can find The UFO Rabbit Hole on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube, or wherever else you listen to podcasts. Just search for The UFO Rabbit Hole. And if you like what you hear and you want to go even further down the rabbit hole with me, I'd like to invite you to join my Patreon community. Patrons get perks like early access to new content and ad-free episodes. I host twice monthly patron-only Zoom calls where you can ask me questions, share your own thoughts, and connect with others. We also have a lively and active private Discord server where members host book clubs, happy hours, and just share their thoughts on all things anomalous without all the drama that's all too common on social media. It's a warm, open-minded, and vibrant community, and we'd love to have you join us. Memberships start at just $5 a month. You can sign up at patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole. That's patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole.
We're back. We're talking to Preston Dennett from my brand new, beautiful studio created by Crystal Kelly, who's been on Dreamland recently, and she is her team are also now my social media team. That's why you're seeing all kinds of new reels and stuff on Instagram, and it is getting to be loads and loads of fun. And so keep up with me on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter. I'm not on Twitter as much, but Instagram and Facebook and TikTok, yes, I'm there. So if that's where you are, look for Whitley Strieber. I'll be there. Preston, let's go on now. You go down. Another fascinating part of the phenomenon that you cover is the ability to call down UFOs. Now, I know John Martin in Georgia who does that very effectively. And there are others who do it as well. Some it's in. So let's talk a little bit about that, will you?
Yeah, I think this is a really interesting facet, which of course has gotten a lot of real attention lately over the past few decades, close encounters of the fifth kind, human-initiated encounters. And this has great potential because it allows you to study not UFO reports passively, but actually do live field work and study the phenomena in live present time. And of course, has the potential to really go much farther than that. Anyone can see a UFO, skeptics, believers alike. This offers that opportunity and also to develop a relationship and perhaps even have onboard experiences and more. So I think the potential is incredible, really limitless. And it's been going on for quite a long time. A lot of people have been doing this. I became interested in this when I interviewed this gentleman by the name of Arnie Weiler, who was working for NBC and decided to do this publicity stunt for them in Santa Monica. This is at the La Brea Tar Pits, the George Page Museum. He was working with a special effects guy, Rick Liebert, and they had set up these pixel lights, computerized lights, in the shape of a peacock's tail, the NBC logo. And it looks kind of like almost a full disc, sort of mimicking the appearance of a UFO, which might be significant here because when they turn this on, this whole setup, all these colored lights, they turned it on and it was starting to lift up. Three UFOs came swooping down very quickly as if to examine it, which was amazing. And Arnie shouted out to Rick Liebert, "Hey, look, UFOs." And Rick kind of brushed it off as if it was a casual thing and said, "Oh, this happens all the time when I do this kind of work." So I did this interview with Arnie Weiler. I'm like, "You need to put me in touch with Rick Liebert." And he confirmed it and gave me another case.
Wow. That's amazing, Preston. I have to tell you, it's very, very extraordinary. It's as if could they have mistaken it like a decoy duck? I mean, are there any other cases where people intentionally try to decoy them? Of course, there are many, but I don't think I know one that worked in Kathleen Martin's book, Taken. There's a story of a guy who owned a small airport like a bush airport in the desert somewhere. And a UFO landed at the end of his runway. And he started putting out all kinds of light glow lights and things. And it came back. And the end of the story was the guy finally went crazy because they came into his hangar and into his bedroom in the little operation he had. And he shot one of them and it haunted him. And the next thing you know, he's crazy and dies. Wow. So it's quite a story. But tell us more, if you will, about this whole subject, because like every UFO subject, if I ask you to go into detail, you can talk for 2 hours.
Yeah, I mean, I found this to be quite interesting because I thought the same thing. I'm like, well, did they not know that this was a UFO or what's going on here? Because I did find a case in Arizona where some people had purposefully set up a fake UFO and it brought down a craft as if to examine it. I found other cases of a light festival in Nevada that was taking place. UFO came down for that. And speaking with Rick Liebert, who was involved in the Santa Monica case, he said back in 1978, because I asked him, tell me another case. You say this happens often. He says, well, you know, one case I can tell you vividly because I remember it really well. 1978, the tallest building then in San Diego, a bank building. He was working with the local radio station doing publicity. They'd set up an argon laser to play and beat to this rock station. And no sooner had they set it up, they've gotten FAA approval and all the things you need to do. 10 of them were up there on the top of this building and turned on this green argon laser, and it started to play and beat to the music. No sooner had they done this when two craft showed up, V-shaped, with little lights along each end. One was quite low. He said it was probably 50 feet overhead. He says it was hard to tell how big it was or how close it was, but very low. Another one was several hundred feet up, and it just moved slowly over. They could hear it thrumming, and off it went. And it was just fascinating because this was a publicity stunt like the other one. And yeah, it generated some attention, not the kind they were expecting. But wow, this is when I joined CSETI, which was spearheaded, of course, by Stephen Greer. And he had come to LA to form a CSETI group. And I became part of that group. And over the next 5 years or so, we did meditation and used lights to call down UFOs successfully on at least a half dozen occasions. I mean, one was stupendous. We were communicating back and forth with this object with our flashlights.
This is Stephen Greer's protocol?
Yeah, yeah. I spoke with him about it. It's funny, I wrote those two cases in UFO Universe magazine. He's like, you know, I read that, and that's what really inspired me to get CSETI going. I thought was a really nice thing to say, and wow, that's very cool.
Well, his protocols work. He's apparently, you're not the first person who's told me that they've had extraordinary experiences using his protocols or in his groups. So, you know, he's a very controversial guy. I hear all kinds of things about him, but I never pay any attention to any of that. That's not how I operate. But he does have a bottom line, and that is a lot of people are successful who call in UFOs in ways that he suggests. Gosh, I remember going all the way back into the 80s, I guess, Bootsy Galbraith, who was John Kenneth Galbraith's wife, was a friend of Anne's. She had a lot of Hotsy friends, social friends in New York. And she had gone to Mexico with Stephen Greer and seen UFOs on that trip. And she was very impressed with this.
Uh-huh. Yeah, there's a lot of cases. I found three separate cases of people who use massive searchlights. And there was a very famous case in Ohio, Norwood, Ohio, from 1949 to 1950, where UFOs showed up on, I think, 10 separate occasions every time they turned on this massive searchlight. And they caught it on film, photographs. There's a very famous photograph where you can see this UFO in the searchlight beam, and it's bending the beam of light right up to it, which is something you can't really fake. This generated interest at very high levels of government, who really refused to comment on it. Don't think it even made it into Project Blue Book, but it's a very well documented case with a lot of trained observers who should know if something this is an unusual craft or not.
Yeah, you'd think. But you know, they're so when it comes to the government is so obsessively secretive. They're so secretive that they've almost proved that the UFOs actually exist But, you know, if they didn't exist, it would be a lot easier to hide and there would be less hidden. But it is there's a vast amount hidden, there are enormous amounts. And that to me proves that it is real more than anything.
Yeah, I'm astonished by how many cases there are. The more I dig into this, there's just an endless number of people who've had encounters like this. I don't think the general public has any real idea how many people have seen UFOs.
Okay, here's another part of the book that is so great that I loved, because it's, you know, people say to me, don't always tell your story on your shows, but my story is part of this. So what I'm going to say here is, before I ask Preston, without telling you what it is, I'm going to say, this happened to me. And now, Preston, what I want to do you to do is to tell about appearances of ETs at UFO conferences. And if you have any information about hybrids, I don't absolutely remember in the book, add that in too. But that's the next question.
Yeah, this was something that kind of caught my attention when I think it was Reverend John Polk put out a book called Blue Beings at UFO Conference. And I thought, well, isn't that interesting? Because 1994, the Triad Conference, March of 1994, down in Coronado Island, San Diego, I attended that conference. There was a lot of really interesting speakers there, like Colin Andrews and Yvonne Smith and Bud Hopkins and others. And now it's a very well-known incident, which Yvonne Smith has written a book about. I co-wrote a book with one of the witnesses, because the evening before the conference, many people had a visitation. When they were staying at the Village Inn right next to the Coronado. This is not at the conference proper, the night before it. But it got me intrigued, because it wasn't long after that that I was speaking at another conference in Irvine. This was, let me see, I guess it was sometime after 2015. But I was speaking about USOs, unidentified submersible objects, and found out that UFOs were seen. Well, someone was taken from their hotel room by Grays, Jonathan Michael Knox, I think is his name. And he was healed of a torn Achilles tendon. He had a roommate who saw the Grays. She was taken on board. She said she saw speakers who were at the conference on board the craft. And it's not just one or two testimonies. There was another of a group of people. This was reported to New Fork, National UFO Reporting Center, who saw UFOs hovering over the hotel on that same evening. And that's when I started connecting the dots. I'm like, are there other cases like this? And yeah, there were quite a few, about a dozen. And some, were first-hand reports of apparent ETs walking among the population. Others are UFOs hovering over the conference. And there was a really amazing incident, contact in the desert.
Oh, yeah.
2016 in Joshua Tree.
Well, I was there.
Numerous people saw objects flying around and caught on film, viewed through binoculars, night vision goggles. Many hundreds of witnesses, several made reports to MUFON and New Fork.
Yeah, because the UFOs were visible. I mean, they weren't satellites either. They were, in other words, I saw some of them myself. Another one that used to have UFOs over the conferences is the Gulf Breeze UFO conference. I went there for many years, and they had UFOs show up every year virtually. I mean, not only Buddy, the red UFO that would fly along the horizon at the sea, but also right over, like we were eating breakfast once in a diner near the conference, and people came rushing in and said, "There's a UFO over the diner." And now we know why, because it was all a bunch of UFO investigators sitting together at breakfast, and there was a UFO over the diner. So it happens.
It's strangely appropriate, isn't it? I mean, kind of you would expect it with so many people who are not only interested in studying the subject, but who have had experiences themselves.
So that Anne used to say it's a process of acclimatization. There's a theater in the sky because they're taming us. They're getting us used to them.
I think they're doing a publicity campaign. You know,
I think
hundreds of UFOs in the sky. There was one in Farmington, New Mexico, around 1953, I think it was. No, 1950. That involved hundreds of objects. Most of the town saw it. This is 3,000 people. it stopped traffic in the street. Schools came out, you know, people came out of their businesses. The mayor saw it, police, the newspaper office. This was a clear display. I think that's going the same thing going on in these conference encounters.
Yeah. Now, I think that, yeah, because let's sort of circle back to aliens at conferences, because I've seen a couple of things at Contact in the Desert that were not, I don't think, were human beings. They looked human, sort of, but, and I was close enough to one of them to get a good look. And it was not a costume, it was just a person with very little body hair and very pale. And I thought I heard someone say, in this sort of soft voice, you know, mild, very mild voice, "Hello, Whitley." And I'm not sure, though, if it was someone who said that physically or it came from this person who was sitting beside me, because I didn't see anyone around me. There was no one behind me and no one followed up. I mean, you'd think if that you someone says, "Hello, Whitley," then you look at a smiling face and you say hello back. So I thought it might have been a telepathic message.
Wouldn't surprise me. I've heard of cases like that. ETs are seen in public places all the time, places you would never expect. And I've talked to many people who've had that kind of experience. One guy was at a street fair. He was a street vendor in San Francisco selling jewelry and had someone come up to his table and was talking to him telepathically, but it took him a bit to catch on to this. And he asked her to try on the rings and she wouldn't do it. And finally, she walked away, but turned around and said, "This is why I can't wear your jewelry," and pulled out her hands, which were not normal by any means. Very long, slender, kind of bony, almost clawish hands. And then he got a quick flash of, you know, not a quite fully human appearance, but very dark eyes and bald head, which he did not see that when she was walking up to the table. So there's some ability, you know,
The grays can do that. Yeah. They can, like, in my book, Them, there's a story of a guy whom I know now, and he's a very real human being. There's nothing unusual about him, except when he was in the army, he had a girlfriend and fell in love with her. And they finally, after a long time of him, of course, wanting nothing else, and she being a girl and being careful, they went to bed together. After which, she called him over to her flat, to her apartment, and sat him down and said, "I'm going to show you something, and then you're never going to see me again after tonight." And he was, of course, shocked. Oh, no, because he's in love with this woman. She sits across from him and slowly turns into a gray and then back into a human being. And he was so shocked when she said for him to leave, that, you know, goodbye. He just left. And she was gone after that. He never saw her again. And I said to him, "What do you think? What do you think she did that for?" And he said, "Well, I don't know." And I said, "Well, I do know. You've got a child somewhere. She's had a baby with you. That's what it was all about from beginning to end."
Got a few cases like that. One guy interviewed personally.
Tell us some stories. I'm fascinated, of course.
Yeah, one gentleman I interviewed for my book, Humanoids in High Strangeness, had a very weird day where he first saw two tall guys dressed up in suits who he thought were CIA guys, but clearly weren't. Later that day, he saw them again. They were dressed in robes, and he had a telepathic conversation. I'm shortening this because it's a fairly long story, and I want to get to the interesting part where he was going home. He's a young man, 19, 20 years old. This is in Oregon. And this lady, who's wearing the same robes, walks up to him, and she's strangely perfect. Her hair is very manicured. And she's attractive, and basically said, offered an intimate relationship in very straightforward language. And he's a young man, you know, always looking for a good time. Sure. And takes her home. And she was very awkward in her, the way she interacted. And gosh, it's hard to talk about this without getting into really graphic terms, because it was a very graphic relationship he had with her. And she was basically instructing him, don't do this, don't do that. You know, we'll get an infection. And he said she was not normal anatomically. Let me put it that way. Her skin seemed almost rubbery. And at one point he had a vision of her absolutely bald and with large dark eyes. And she quickly ended the intimacy and walked out. And that's when he did. He got a good view of her, and she didn't have hair like he thought. And I forget what it was. She said something along the lines of, yeah, this was something she wanted to experience. And I know of other cases. I mean, real quick, another lady went to a gas station, saw this beautiful, handsome man, and he seduced her. She does not take guys home, she said, but went home with him. This was in Florida. Ended up having intimate relations, looks in the mirror and sees his reflection. And it's not this handsome man with blonde hair and blue eyes. It's a gray. He immediately walked into the bathroom. This bathroom has no windows. There's no escape. And he didn't come out. She opens the door and he's gone. Boom.
And they can go right through a wall.
Yeah.
You know, you wonder who they are, because if they want to cohabit with us and make love with us, then they must be able to have babies with us. And would that not explain the female in the first story you told being sort of on the edge of human? There were things about her that were almost human. That's correct. And maybe she was literally a hybrid who was more like three quarters gray and one quarter human. And it means that we can interbreed, which means that we're somehow or another from the same, we have something, we have very similar genes. Very similar. Yeah. And yet the way they look and what they can do is not close.
Yeah, I think they are clearly, well, not only technologically advanced, but psychically advanced. But I do think that they're probably human, almost, because when people do encounter ETs, humanoids, they're bipedal almost always. There are a few exceptions and outliers, but the fact that there are ones that look pretty much just like us, and then we have grays and, you know, praying mantids and short humanoids and little blue beings and tall whites and so forth. But if you look at the variation of ancestry on Earth alone, I'm wondering if you could stick in an ET here or there and probably fit right in. So many contactees have been told the same message. We are you, you are us, we are one, we share a common heritage. You know, one day we used to look like you, or one day you will look like us, this sort of thing. So yeah, I think this speaks really strongly to our relationship to them, which is probably much closer, I think, than perhaps we recognize.
Well, yeah, I think, you know, and Secretary Laurie Barnes was told that in the 50s when she had one of her only UFO confrontations. She had a very few, but they were very, very spectacular. And that was with these dark blue dwarf-like figures that often show up with the grays. And one of them said, when she said, he said, why do you fear us? And she said, because you're so ugly. And he said, one day, my dear, you will look just like us. What can it mean? Preston, you got any ideas? Because she's not the only one who reports that, as you said.
I think it's a clear message that we are them, they are us, that we share a common heritage. It's such a common message. You know, ET is repeating themselves.
Somebody. I mean, given the way they look and the way we look, someone's deformed. Who is it? Which ones?
Well, you know, the grays, people who have been taken on board the grays, and they collect genetic material have been told, you know, we have suffered some genetic damage, which has caused problems with reproduction. So I think that there's something going on there that perhaps they're trying to repair or reinvigorate their DNA. Hard to say for sure. This is still a relatively new field in terms of being taken seriously and studied.
Well, I think hopefully there'll be enough information to study it soon. Free side, we have come to the end of our time together. I would like to thank you all, as always, for being with us. Subscribers, stay with us because we're getting into the areas of human levitation and out-of-body experiences. Preston knows a lot about these and he can go out of his body. So we're going to learn about all of that. And I want to know his suggestions as to how we can do this, because I've had it happen a few times and it is fun. Free Dreamlanders, remember Preston's book is Not From Here. It's available on bookstores and Amazon, I'm sure. And his website is prestondennett.weebly.com.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.